wanted to share a song. You might have heard this one on the radio. I'm kind of late to the game on hearing about it, but great song. Just so relatable. The idea that God is the same God today as he was yesterday, and he'll be the same God tomorrow. He's the God of the New Testament and the Old Testament. Many, many times people think God changed, but he was true to himself. He was faithful to himself, to his word, to his character, to his promises, and he is the same today. And so we want to share this with you. Hopefully, if you've heard it, I would love for you to sing it loud with us. I'm going to share the chorus with you so that when we come around to that, you can sing it loud with us. But I want to encourage you just to reflect on trusting in God's faithfulness. Do you truly do that? Do you believe he is the same? Or do you feel like he might let you down tomorrow? Do you trust his promises? Do you trust that if he was faithful when you were saved, that he will be faithful at the end of your life or the next trial you go through? Do you believe that he's the same God that rescued the Israelites? He's the same God that healed the leper, and he is healing lives today. He's healing hearts. He's healing minds. He's healing relationships. He is the Savior then. He is the Savior now. So I'm going to share the chorus with you. Just a cry of saying, God, I need you, and I want to trust in your faithfulness. So it's like this.
Oh, God, my God, I need you. Oh, God, my God, I need you now. How I need you now. Oh, rock of ages, I'm standing on your faithfulness. On your faithfulness.
Mess up the words, give me grace. There's a lot of words that are similar, so.
I'm calling on the God of Jacob, whose love endures through generations. I know that you will keep your covenant. Calling on the God of Moses, the one who opened up the ocean. I need you now to do the same thing for me.
Oh God, my God, sing it out.
Oh God, calling on the God of Mary, whose favor rests upon the lowly. I know with you all things are possible. I'm calling on the God of David, who made a shepherd boy to may not face Goliath, but I've got my own giants. Oh God, my God, I need you now. How I need you now. Oh rock of ages, I'm standing on. your children. You hear your children. You are the same God. You are the same God. You answered prayers back then, and you will answer. You are the same God. You are the same God. You were providing then. You are providing now. You are the same God.
Believe it.
Death acclaimed its victory. The King of Love had given up his life. The darkest day in history. There on a cross they made for sinners. For every curse his blood atoned. Final breath, and it was finished. And not the end we could have known. For the earth began to shake, and the veil was torn. Sacrifice was made as the heavens rose.
Thank you. was lost across eternity. Amen, God. We love you. We lift you high. All glory to you, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Good job singing, church. We love you. Thanks for joining in with us. With that, kids, you're dismissed. The rest of us, why don't we stay standing? Let's greet our neighbors. Say hi to somebody standing next to you.
Good evening, Rock Church. How's everyone doing tonight? Good, good, good. Hopefully you met someone new. Let's go ahead and grab our seats. We're going to roll through some announcements super fast, and we're going to wrap up our Delighting in God's Word series. So welcome. Welcome to the Rock Church. Hopefully you were handed a program on your way in. Everything I'm going to talk about is inside that program. There's a whole bunch of stuff tonight. There's a postcard. There's a handout. So make sure you're flipping through that, reading through the bulletin, getting all the good details, because I'm going to blitz through it. But welcome. If this is your first time coming, go ahead and flip to the back side of that program. There's a little section there. It says Get Connected. That's your way of getting connected with us. So you can fill out some information about yourself. We'd love to figure out how you heard about The Rock Church. Were you invited by a friend or family member? Maybe a neighbor invited you, but make sure you check those boxes, especially the box that says crumble cookies. If this is your first time, we'd love to send you a free box of cookies for coming and hanging out with us, so make sure you check that box and put down your email address so we can contact you. So welcome. Let's roll through announcements. First up, we have... I didn't memorize them, so I need to... All right, baby bottle campaign. So if you guys noticed when you came in, there's a whole table full of baby bottles out there. We are not giving out free baby food tonight. What this is an awesome fundraiser with one of the organizations that we partner with here at The Rock Church, Pregnancy Resource Center. This is their main fundraiser for the full year. This is how they raise pretty much all of their funds to operate for the year. What this is you take a baby bottle, you take it home, crack open that piggy bank that the kids have been putting all their money in. You take that money, put it in the baby bottle, and bring it back. The deadline for those baby bottles back is April 23rd. If you don't have a piggy bank at home, maybe you're like, Brent, it's 2023. There's no such thing as change anymore. It's called Venmo. You can do that. trc.life/babybottle. You go to that link. They have a little landing page there, a website that you can go and you can donate to Pregnancy Resource Center. We do have an awesome video that kind of promotes Pregnancy Resource Center. So, oh, that's cool. Your change.
The loose coins you find tucked in your couch, collecting in your car, or lingering in your laundry room can all add up in a big way to save the life of a baby. Your local pregnancy center is making a life-changing, life-saving difference, reaching women in the midst of their unplanned pregnancy. Pregnancy centers offer help and hope, empowering women every day to make a better choice for them and for their babies. Life. Your coins, dollars, and checks may touch one life or many. They'll help cover the cost of a free pregnancy test, life-affirming counsel, baby supplies, and even a life-saving ultrasound. Did you know that over 80% of abortion-minded women who see their babies on an ultrasound change their minds and choose life instead of abortion? That beating heart, tiny fingers, and little toes all display the splendor of creation, connecting a mom to her child, compelling her to choose life. Your change can change lives. Anyone can fill a bottle, or even two. Moms, dads, aunts and uncles, grandmas and grandpas, children of all ages. As your bottle fills up, you get closer and closer to providing life-affirming options for women who desperately need them. When you return your baby bottle, you're giving the gift of hope, upholding the dignity of every single life. Will you be the change? Your change will make a difference for life.
All right, there you go. So if you have more questions out at the table, there's a flyer there that will tell you a little bit more about Pregnancy Resource Center and the campaign. But make sure you grab a baby bottle and please return it, because even if you don't fill it, they still need those bottles back because it costs money to do those. And that's counterintuitive. They would like the money in the bottle. So bring the bottle back April 23rd, or you can do it online, trc.life/babybottle. Next up on our announcements. Yes, Every Heartbeat. Is there a musician on stage? No? Caleb? Do you want to do? All right, never mind. He's not excited about it, so I'll be excited about it. Who's already listened to the new song that got released on Friday? Yes. Available now, trc.life/everyheartbeat, an oldie but a goodie, but remastered. This is an amazing song. This is an awesome opportunity for you, church, to also be sharing this with those people that need to hear truth. They need to hear uplifting music that will give them hope and encouragement and lead them to Jesus. So go to this link. There's a bunch of different platforms that the music is available on. You can also do it on our app, but we prefer Spotify because, you know, we love to give them money. We love to support them. So go listen to this new song. Listen to it in the car. Listen to it on your phone. Make sure your kids are listening to it all day long, because the more it gets listened to, the higher up it goes in the charts, which means more people get to hear about Jesus. Amen? All right, go support the rock music. Go listen to the new song. There's more good stuff coming on that song in the near future. So next up on our announcements, Rockmen. It's almost Monday. Monday night, 7 p.m., we'll be right here in this room. Pastor Billy has an awesome message prepared for you men. So make sure you have this on your calendar. Set reminders. We start at 7 p.m. That means you get to Harmon's at 6:55, and then you come here with your cookies or your treats that you pick up there, and we'll get started at 7 o'clock. We'll have some snacks. We'll do some worship, a message, and then an awesome time of discussion and prayer. So, men, make sure you have this on the calendar. Make sure you make it a priority. We need to be coming together as men of the church and encouraging one another. So, next up on our announcements, Missions Gala. Who's got their tickets for the Missions Gala? A few of you. Awesome. Hey, if you have not purchased tickets yet for the Missions Gala, please do. We need to kind of get a head count for all the delicious gourmet food that they're going to be making from all the different countries that will be represented. You can go to trc.life/missionsgala. You can get registered. Again, 16 or older, don't bring your kids. We'll stop you at the door and say, sorry. So Friday, it's coming up quick. It's less than a week away. We're super excited. There are so many auction items. There's more and more getting added every day. We're super excited. There's more auction items than we've ever had, and some really cool stuff, different experiences, trips, some awesome art. There's a whole bunch of stuff, gift baskets, date night packages. If you want to see any of those auction items, as a reminder, it's all online this year. So even if you're not coming, although we'd prefer that you come because it's the experience that you're going to enjoy. trc.life/auction. You'll get to see all the different auction items. Of course, you can start looking at them now, but bidding does not go live until the night of the gala. So Friday at 6:30, that's when bidding goes live on all those auction items. There's a whole bunch of instructions on that site. It's an awesome platform. It's pretty user intuitive. You'll figure it out pretty quick. But go look at all the auction items and get excited about it, and then you can still buy a ticket to come and be a part of that. So Missions Gala is coming up Friday. Buy your tickets. Next up on our announcements. Baptisms, Easter weekend. We're so excited. This is probably the biggest weekend to get baptized here at the Rock Church. So many people love to get baptized on Easter weekend. The deadline to do that is April 2nd. If you have not been baptized, Jesus commands you to go read your Bible or go to the Connections booth. We have the verses already for you in a whole study guide, a whole packet that talks about biblical baptism. We'd love to walk you through that. We'd love to get you signed up to get dunked in the cattle trough on Easter weekend. trc.life/baptism, the deadline to sign up for that, April 2nd. Next up, more Easter stuff. Death of Death, it's coming up next weekend. We start our first part of a two-part series. Pastor Caleb's going to bring an awesome Palm Sunday message the first weekend, and then the following weekend, Pastor Brian's going to knock it out of the park with our Easter service. It's going to be super awesome. If you look in your program right now, what do you have in your program? A postcard. Isn't that beautiful? Yeah, don't put it on your fridge, though. That's in your bulletin, because we are going to challenge you, church, to invite somebody to Easter weekend. That postcard is your invite. You can go bring it to your neighbors, coworkers, family members. Bring that. Use it. Use it to invite people. This is one of the biggest weekends of the church, or of the year for the church. So please be inviting people. No shame, but if you are not going to use that to invite somebody, please don't throw it away. Don't take it home or leave it in your car. We will use it. We will use it to invite somebody. So no shame, but there's a little table on your way out of the room. If you don't want to bring that home, you don't want to invite someone, put it on the table. We'll add it to the programs next weekend, or we'll use it to go and knock on doors throughout the community close to the church, and we'll hand that postcard out. But we challenge you, church, to do this. We want you to be the hands and feet. We want you to be inviting the people that you know of that need to come to this service. So bring that home. Start praying about who you're going to give it to. Don't put it on your fridge. I know it's really beautiful. You want to keep it, but give it out to somebody, okay? All right, next up, bake sale. Part of our Easter weekend is our youth group bake sale. This is the biggest fundraiser for our youth group. This helps them go to conferences, helps them do fun things. Sometimes in the winter, they go sledding or tubing. Sometimes in the summer, they go to like movie theaters. But this is an awesome opportunity to support the youth right here in this church. So what the bake sale is you bake it, you bring it, you buy it. So Easter weekend, you're going to bake some goodies. You're going to make some cookies, a cake, some cupcakes. You're going to bring it on Easter weekend. They're going to put it out on a table. It's going to sit there for about an hour and a half. And then on your way out, you're going to buy it. And you're going to take it home and you're going to eat it. And all that money goes to helping the youth group with different conferences and stuff that they can do throughout the year. So that's coming up. Start thinking about those delicious treats that you're going to bake. And then make sure it's on your calendar, set a reminder. So next up on our announcements, reminders. Whew, we're finally here. You guys feel like you're running a marathon sometimes? Yeah. All right, small groups. Make sure you're getting connected. Stay plugged into a small group. If you're not, go to the Connections booth. Ask some questions. We'll get you plugged in. Need prayer? trc.life/pray. That's our online prayer request form. If you have anything that you need prayer for, please fill that out. Hit submit. The pastors would love to be praying for you. You could do it the old-fashioned way. There's a box back there. You can fill it out and drop it in the box. And then lastly, tithe and offering. If you'd love to give back to the Lord because he's given us everything, we should give him back a little bit. Tithe and offering, trc.life/give. You could text to give. You can drop it in the box. We're not going to pass a plate. It's just between you and the Lord. So that's it for all of our announcements. You guys ready to wrap up the series? Let's do it.
What do you delight in? What brings you joy or pleasure? When was the last time you truly adored something? To delight is to be greatly pleased, and Psalm 119 is full of this wonder. It is the longest chapter in the Bible and likens his word to honey for our lips and a lamp to our feet. There is joy, freedom, and praise to be found in this psalm. God's word is worthy of our delight and is written to connect us to Jesus.
All right. Hey, first thing, why don't we give y'all a round of applause? You made it through all of those announcements. That was a lot this weekend. That's a good thing. It's a burden when your church, yeah, I know, I wish it were longer, man. It's a good thing when your church is doing so many good things that it's kind of hard to tell you very quickly of all the things that are happening. So you guys should be encouraged. Lots of stuff that Brent said. Men's night on Monday. Brothers, let's be there. This Death of Death looks so awesome. I'm so excited about this. Use this, really. Don't give it back to us. Go invite somebody to church, okay? Physical challenge, family double dare, triple dog dare. You can do that, okay? It's Easter. It's the week you really get to brag about how amazing your Lord and Savior Jesus Christ is. Amen? So invite some homies to church with you on Easter. All right, so welcome, Pastor Brian here. We are going to finish this series called Delighting in God's Word. And hey, homies, I've lost the panic monitor, and I'm already panicking, and I haven't even looked up to notice the panic monitor is gone. So nobody look, but everything's fine. Nobody turn around. But I am panicking with no panic monitor. Don't worry, I got the Bible. I know what I'm doing. Pastor Brian here. I don't panic over little things. And we are finishing up this series. We are on the 12th and final week. We've been looking at this really long prayer that we find in the 119th Psalm, written thousands of years ago, right here in the middle of our Bible. Some series listening to us, it's all good. Specifically, we've been looking, what is written here has the power and authority to change our lives. Every area of our lives is transformed by the power of God's word. And that's really a bold statement to make, if I'm right. That's a bold statement, amen? My guys are here. Y'all are going to have to catch up with my homies over here, right? This is no ordinary book. To say that this is where the living God communicates with us, that's a really bold claim to make, right? To say that prayer is how we communicate with the living God, that's no ordinary thing. That is a bold claim. To say that when we come here to God's word, that when we believe and we treasure in who it is that we meet when we come here, it changes every aspect of our lives. That's a really bold claim. And for 12 weeks, we've been talking about the different areas that scripture, specifically just the psalmist prayer, the way that God's word has the power to change and influence our lives. And if you remember first week, Pastor Josh picked it up. He picked this whole series off. He talked about the sermon. It was called The Unchanging Word. We talked about how this book, God's word, has never changed. It can't change. It only tells the truth. There is no ever. There never will need to be a change. It doesn't change. But yet, this book, God's word, changes everything about us. It changes eternal destinies. It gives us real purpose and value and identity and who we are and what we're here for. It gives us joy and hope. It changes how we see the entire world. So today, Josh started the series with the unchanging word, and today we're going to wrap it up, and our sermon this weekend is titled Changed by the Word. And our text is Psalm 119, verses 73 to 80. So if you have your Bibles, I would encourage you to open them up. They look like this. They're made out of paper usually. Yeah. See, these guys are a who, huh? So if you read Hebrew, you would know that the first letter in each one of these verses is the Hebrew letter Yod, which kind of sounds like Yoda. And if this was Pastor Josh, I'd have some Star Wars reference for you. And he's not here, and I don't have one for you. So next time you go to Psalm 119, you'll see a word that says, it looks like somebody spelled Yoda wrong. There's your joke. It looks like Yoda's in the Bible, spelled wrong. It's Yod. And one definition for this word simply means hand or arm or to stretch, which is really fascinating because we're talking about this prayer to God, right? So in a way, this psalmist in these verses, in every verse in the Psalms, is really a hand or an arm being stretched up. We're communicating, we're talking to the living God. And so with our time, I want us to look at this prayer, this yod, this arm, this stretching prayer, that the things that the psalmist believes is radical, it's bold, and it's life-changing. What he believes about his relationship with God and his relationship with himself and his relationship with others. And specifically this weekend, that's what I want us to look at, to see how this is the same reality for us. So if you have your Bibles, you can follow along with me. I also printed the verses for you on your handout if you want to follow along. But we'll read these and then we'll get going. So starting in verse 73 of Psalm 119, Yod. Duh. Your hands have made and fashioned me. Give me understanding that I may learn your commandments. Those who fear you shall see me and rejoice because I have hoped in your word. I know, O Lord, that your rules are righteous, that in faithfulness you have afflicted me. Let your steadfast love comfort me according to your promise to your servant. Let your mercy come to me that I may live, for your law is my delight. Let the insolent be put to shame because they have wronged me with falsehood. As for me, I will meditate on your precepts. Let those who fear you turn to me that they may know your testimonies. May my heart be blameless in your statutes that I may not be put to shame. Did you notice the conversation that the author is having with the living God? It changes everything about him. Today we're going to look at how God's word changes his relationship with God, his relationship even with himself and with one another. So if you'd bow your heads and pray with me, and we will get going. Lord, we love you. We thank you for your word. Your word is truth. Your word is a lamp that guides our feet. Your word gives comfort. Your word is sweeter than honey. Lord, I pray for your sons and your daughters this weekend that they would come here. They want to hear from you. And when we open up your word, we want to hear from you, the living, personal, knowable, teaching, comforting God. So I ask, Lord, that the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart would be acceptable in your sight, Jesus Christ, our rock, our redeemer. And all God's children said, amen. All right. So your first big idea this weekend is, like we just mentioned, God changes our relationships with him. Again, notice you just heard how this psalmist speaks to God is pretty profound. He speaks like God is real, right? Verse 73, your hands have made and fashioned me. The first thing that the psalmist understands is you're God. You are the one who made me. This is the same language we see in scripture, right? That God is our creator. You go Genesis chapter 1, in the beginning God created. We're talking God's hands created the heavens and the earth. In John 1, it says that Jesus Christ, who is fully God, there is nothing in all creation that weren't made by his hands. And in Genesis chapter 1, again, you see that God created us in his image. God's hands is all over our lives. The psalmist is proclaiming something that he believes, that God is our creator. He made us, and we can know him. Give me understanding that I may learn. So not only is God our God and he is our creator, but we can know him. He's personal. He says, God, you can speak to me and I can understand and I can learn from you. He's speaking to God like he's a person, isn't he? God is not a force. He's a person revealed perfectly in the person of Jesus Christ. He is knowable. He gives us understanding. Further, you can keep going down, look in these verses. This is verse 75, right? We see that not only is God God, not only is he knowable and personal, but he actually teaches us, right? Verse 75, I know, O Lord, your rules are righteous. God has rules. God has standards for living, what is right and what is wrong. And additionally, sometimes the Lord has to instruct and correct us and train us, like it says here. Sometimes the Lord afflicts you. Sometimes the God has to give you a little discipline to get your attention. Sometimes we get some love and some reproof and some correction and some training in righteousness. Sometimes God uses affliction to get our attention. I preached on that a few weeks ago, if you'd like to listen to that sermon. But not just that. God is not just God. He's not just knowable and personal. He doesn't just teach and instruct and sometimes discipline his children. He also comforts us. The psalmist believes this. Verse 76, let your steadfast love, what? Comfort me. God comforts him. He believes it. Verse 77, God's mercy. Let your mercy come to me that I may live. I mean, the psalmist is saying all these incredible, deeply rich and profound theological truths and implications for someone who knows the living God. He believes God is a person that he communicates and depends on. His whole life has been changed by this God. And we've unpacked all of these topics. We could go through it. These sermons over the last 13 weeks, 12 weeks. We've been unpacking all of this, so I won't waste any more time. But the big thing we need to see just in these verses is we need to see how the psalmist sees God. It's a teaching rule for us. He knows that he can know God. You need to know that you can know God. A real loving God. Right? That has to make sense to you, right? If you don't get this right, nothing in your life will ever make sense. Nothing makes sense if you don't know God. The great theologian, minister, preacher, Anglican pastor, and author, J.I. Packer said it this way. Once you become aware that the main business that you are here for is to know God, most of life's problems fall into place of their own accord. I love that. That's really good. When you know God, everything makes sense. You see things clearer. You see things through a right lens when God has shown up into your life. When you've experienced, like the psalmist, that God is real. He's personal. You can know him. When you believe that, he will really change you. The psalmist knows God, and he depends on him in a real way. But I think there's a word of warning here for us. We need to know the difference, right? Knowing about God and knowing God are two very different things, am I right? I believe this needs to be something we think about. You can know a lot about God and not know God. You can go to Matthew 7 in your Bible if you would like. But what I'm saying is you can read Bible. You can own Bibles. You can go on mission trips. You can go to church. You can serve at church. You can tithe. You can give of your time. You can have people into your home. You can study Bible hours and hours a day and still not know God in a life-changing way. Jesus goes a little bit further in Matthew chapter 7, verse 21. The Lord says it like this, "Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' will enter the kingdom of heaven." Verse 22, "On that day, many will say to me, 'Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? We'd cast out demons in your name. We do mighty works in your name.' And then I will declare to them, 'God says, I never knew you.'" You can know a lot about God, but not know God. I can know a lot about Aaron Rodgers. That dude doesn't know anything about me. Lord, didn't we go on mission trips in your name? Didn't we volunteer at soup kitchens? And didn't I donate blood? And didn't I hand out sandwiches at the park? Jesus, right here in these verses, he's drawing a line in the sand. You can be very religious You can do lots of church and not know God. You can know lots of Bible. You can do all of the Jesus-y stuff, and you do not live like your life depends on it. It's a hard thing to hear, I know. It's a hard thought. I can explain it like this. Like, I can know a lot about diabetes. I have friends, family who have diabetes. I know some things about it. I can study it. I can learn more about it. I can research it for hours a day. I can even become an endocrinologist or something. I think that's what they might be called. Don't quote me on that. I'm not a doctor. I just play one on Google. I know the benefits that insulin has on people's with busted up and kind of half working or broken pancreases, right? Is that right? It's a pancreas? Something like that. I can encourage people. Yeah, I can see the value in you taking insulin. It sounds like you're a person that needs it, right? But for me, I don't have diabetes. Last time I checked, my pancreas was firing on all cylinders. Therefore, I don't take insulin. The impact that insulin has, it would not be. I don't see the need. I don't need it. It doesn't change me. Now, people who do have diabetes. I have friends, again, who have diabetes. I got a buddy named Robert. He has diabetes. He knows the benefits of insulin. His body kind of actually depends on it. He's even got one of those cool robot things hooked up to him. He's kind of RoboCop. It's kind of cool. But Robert's relationship and his dependency on insulin being pumped into him, it literally changes him. In a similar way, you can understand all of the benefits of someone knowing God and knowing Scripture. You can know all the benefits of how this can change you, but never see your own personal need for him. That is not the posture of the believer, right? The Christian posture is, I have nothing if I don't have you, right? To really know God, it's the equivalent of knowing that your life is missing the most essential key element for survival. And that you cannot function, you cannot live properly without him. You see him as your lifeline. He's essential to you like insulin is for the diabetic, or he's essential to you like a pacemaker is for a failing heart, right? These verses today, the psalmist is proclaiming, he's testifying that he needs God in every way for his survival, and it is true for us as well. Beloved, I challenge you, I encourage you to long for God deeper, a need for him more and more every day for his glory's sake and for your goodness, for your own benefit. Because when you know God in this way, things just change. Again, the lens that you see the world just looks different. And then additionally, I think our next big idea for us is that God not just changes our relationship with him when we know him, but God also changes our relationship with ourselves. Again, look at these verses. I'll just kind of blow through some of these, right? I mean, notice how the psalmist speaks about himself. He sees himself through the lens of how God sees him, and even in the thick of all the trials and the storms that he is in. But in verse 73, your hands have made me. God, you made me. I'm yours. I belong to you. I belong to the one who says that there's nothing in all of creation more valuable than me. Verse 76, he sees himself, I'm God's servant. He sees that he has good for him. There's good things for him to do to live out in this world. I'm God's servant. In verse 77, he says he's a recipient of God's endless mercy to live. That's who he sees himself. I receive mercy. I'm a mercy receiver. That's who I am. I am valuable in verse 79. I'm valuable to other believers. I don't have that up there. My bad. You'll have to believe me. Like, those who see me will rejoice, right? Verse 80, he's like, I will never be put to shame. He's saying all these things about himself, not because he's all howdy and religious and he's just better than everybody, because this is who God says he is. He knows he's a mess. But man, when you become a believer, when you've experienced God, when you know God in a life-changing way, God gives you a whole new identity, right? In 2 Corinthians 5, if anyone is in Christ, they are a new creation. The old one's gone. Shows up all the time. Don't like that guy. Shows up all the time. Get out of here. To hell with that guy, man. Now, that doesn't necessarily mean that we believe that. Right? There's always going to be this battle in our own flesh. You read these things that the psalmist believes about himself. But then you think about all the things that you tell yourself and all the lies that the world tells you about you, what other people may say about you, your insecurities say about you. Maybe it's your depression, what it says about you, or what the devil says about you. And we just keep filling our cups up with all of these lies about how worthless we are. Why do we do that? How many of you would say you are your own worst critic? Like, there's nobody that can pound you to the dirt and make you feel like trash better than yourself. I am preaching to the choir. I don't think there's anybody on this planet that knows how to humiliate me and cut me down quicker to size than myself. I'm good at it. I hate that guy. I don't know why I treat myself that way. Don't be like me. Why do we do that? Stupid. What lies are you believing about yourself today? There are people under my voice this evening that believe endless amounts of lies about yourself. Nobody will ever love me. You think that. You believe that. Nobody will ever understand you. Nobody will understand everything that you're going through. Nobody understands that. I'm just a horrible person. Man, if you knew, if only you knew what I've done, what I'm capable of. All you do is fail. I'm just a failure. I messed up so much. That's all I do. That's all I'm good at. It's too late for me to start over. Why would I even try? Look at my track record. It's embarrassing. You're too dumb. You're just too dumb. I've never been smart. You're just dumb. You've done so many wrong things. Again, man, if people knew how bad my past was, nobody's talking to a guy like me. You're unforgivable. Nobody will ever forgive you. Who told you can be forgiven? For what you've done? No. Other people maybe. You? No, you don't get that. You'll never beat those addictions. No. I don't care what you say. I don't care how many AAs you go to. You'll never be anything but just an addict. You'll never defeat any of you. You'll never win. You'll never conquer your fears. You're just scared. That's all you are. You're just scared. Maybe those are lies you're believing about yourself today. Did I cover just about everybody? I think I covered everybody in the room. We listen to all this noise. We sit in these caves of shame and regret and guilt, and we ingest all of this garbage, and then we live our lives miserable, just miserable lives, believing all of this garbage that God has never said about you. Has God said any one of those things to you ever? He says none of those things. Christian, I think maybe for you today, you need to hear something, that God and his word has delivered you from the darkness of your own mind. He has delivered you from the power of sin and death and the devil, but you won't let him defeat you, your flesh, the lies that you believe. Maybe that's what you need to hear today, that the Lord has delivered you from your own brain. You are not who you think you are or what you think about yourself or what they said about you. You are who Jesus says you are. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the word of God about who you are. Maybe go ahead and just save yourself from a lifetime of hell. And just start believing what God says, who Jesus says you are. Scripture says you're loved by God. You're a new creation. That's not who you are anymore. You're free. You were chosen. God chose to save you and lavish his mercy and grace upon you. That's a scary word. I'm sorry, it's in your Bible though, so you have to just be okay with that. You are forgiven. Past, present, future. You can be forgiven. You are forgiven. That is an identifying mark of a Christian. You are forgiven. You are a masterpiece. A saint. You are never alone. You are clean. You are washed. You are a child of God. I mean, just go ahead and just save yourself from a life of personal hell. Stop believing what you think about yourself and start believing what the Lord says about you. When you read the Psalms, listen to how he sees himself, right? These verses, it's like, this guy absolutely knows he's a wretch. He's a sinner. He's a failure. His sin is deserving of God's wrath and justice perfectly. He gets it, but he also sees how good God's mercy has been to him. How good God has been and how kind and how forgiving and how patient and how comforting God has been to him. He knows he's loved and redeemed. Flawed, yes, very, but also loved and redeemed and forgiven. He sees how God sees him. That's how we should see ourselves. Isn't it incredible to know that the God of the heavens and the earth, who created everything, knows every single thing about you, every nook and cranny of your sin and your shame and your guilt, and he still chooses to love you greater, more deeper, more passionately than anyone you will ever meet on this planet. Today's a great day to really believe that, don't you think? David Pallison, he's an incredible, he was a biblical counselor. He has an incredible book called God's Grace in Your Suffering. He wrote it the year before he died, honestly. It was a great help for me when my father passed, but he's a man who's been with the Lord. He says this, your true identity is who God says you are. You will never discover who you are by looking inside yourself or listening to what others say. Listen, the Lord gets the first word because he made you. He gets the daily word because you live before his face. And he gets the last word because he will administer your final comprehensive life review. Every word, you are covered in grace. Believe it. Knowing God will change not just your relationship with the Lord, but he's going to change your relationship about yourself if you would just choose to believe him. Am I right? And now, so there was a whole other sermon I attached to this sermon. There's one verse in verse 78, and because of time, I just cut the whole thing. There's this whole, I talked to Paul about it for a while. We had a great time. There's this verse in 78. It's just brutal, right? You listen to this. So am I going to preach this sermon right now? I guess we'll see what happens. Listen to this. Let the insolent be put to shame because they have wronged me with falsehood. So I had this whole sermon prepared for y'all about how we're supposed to love our enemies. Jesus says, love your enemies. But then we read these imprecatory psalms from the psalmist who's like, God, kill my enemies. And I had this whole big sermon about how praying for God to destroy my enemies is actually an act of loving my enemies. And I had to cut that whole thing for your sake and for time's sake because Josh Whitney isn't here, but right now he's getting a little stressed. He's like, I hope they're wrapping up right now on vacation. He's worried that you might get a 40-minute sermon. Just kidding. It's not Josh. It's Mr. Han. Oh, I'm telling on everybody tonight. It's your kid's fault, man. Anywho, so that sermon for scratch it. We'll save it for another a rainy day. Your last big idea this evening is God changes our relationships with one another. Again, these are really beautiful verses. Listen to verse 74 and 79. Those who fear you shall see me and rejoice because I have hoped in your word. And then verse 79, let those who fear you turn to me, that they may know your testimonies. Beautiful verses, but both of these verses have a really scary word in them. What's the word? Fear. When we see that word, we think of danger. It's scary. We think about like danger or fire or jumping out of an airplane, or if you're 7, it's trying new foods, or if you're me when you were 7, it's killer clowns from outer space and Freddy Krueger and The Exorcist and all the stuff that you know you should be letting your 7-year-olds watch before bed on a school night. That's not what the word means in this context. For the believer, to fear God is to rightly recognize and see God for who he is. We see him as the great and wonderful God who created everything. It means someone that, it's like to fear is to take refuge in. Man, I am scared of everything in this world, but there's one thing that will keep me safe. That is reverent fear for God. It's like a kid running to a good daddy for his protection from killer clowns from outer space or Freddy Krueger. There's awe and there's wonder and there's adoration. So rightly understood, when you see this word, those who fear you, we're reading, those who really know you, those who have been changed by you, those who see you as God, as personal and loving, who gives mercy and pours out wrath perfectly. And I fear you. He says, those who love you, Lord, will see me and rejoice. Excellent verse for us to think about, right? When we're looking at other believers in our world and our circles, and we go, wow, that person's pretty encouraging. I like that guy. Right? You see those people and they've influenced their life because contagious. You're like, wow, this person clearly knows God in a radical way because they just change. And every time I'm around them, I just feel joy. We all know the value of other believers in our lives, right? When we see them, oh, that makes me happy. But there's this assumption right here, right? Those who fear you shall see me and rejoice. So if I'm to see you, I actually have to see you, right? So there's this understanding assumption right here in the text that we actually are doing life together, that we regularly see each other. And that we have tons of verses in scriptures that communicate this. Here's just a few. John chapter 13, by this all people know that you are my disciples. If you have love for one another, they will know us by our love. Acts 2, all who believed had all things in common. There's this unity there. Hebrews chapter 10, let us consider how to stir up one another in love and good works. There's all these verses that we talked through when we went through Hebrews, when we went through the church series, but there's just very blanket statement that Christians should regularly be involved in doing life and seeing one another. It's an unmistakable mark of the Christian life. When I've experienced God, I know him, there's union and there's communion with the Lord of heaven and earth, and his spirit is in me, and he's daily transforming me, and he's conforming me to become more like Jesus, right? That's sanctification. I'm going to see that in your life. You should hopefully see that in my life, right? I'm going to benefit by seeing God working and changing you. That's going to benefit me. And God working to daily change me should bless you. Our faith should be constantly overflowing into one another's lives. Scripture also says it like this. Like, what does it mean to be a joy to people? Like, you guys know these verses, but the Apostle Paul in 1 Thessalonians, he goes, encourage. When you see someone and you rejoice, it's because they actually encourage you. They build you up. And Paul assumes you're already doing that. Keep doing that. Or the Apostle Peter, he goes, you've received this gift, right? God has blessed you. You know God. You're changed. His spirit is in you. You have gifts for other people's goods. Use it to serve one another. Or you're going to be a bad steward. Don't be a bad steward with God's varied grace. Be a good steward. Your life, your grace, your joy should overflow into the lives of other people. That's the work of God in people's lives. That's sanctification. And I'll tell you, the old me, nah, dude, I don't care about any of that stuff. That doesn't benefit me at all. But when God gets a hold of you, when God changes you, it's going to be impossible to live like that, your old self. And I think we all think of people who are just living testaments to these verses. They're just like, oh, man, that guy's always on fire for Jesus. Or, man, that gal, man, the way that she's, like, she's going through a storm, but, man, she's just shining. She's just, like, bright. She's just salt of the earth. You know, she's a lamp that can't be hidden. Just incredible. Or, like, that dude at Bible study, dude, when he talks, the Bible just comes to life. Or there's this buddy, man, every time I see him, he'll just stop and pray for you. Right? Like, we know these people. You just walk into a room and you see them, and it's just like somebody bumps up the lighting in the room and they walk in. It's like, how do you do that, man? And we're all grateful for those people. We've benefited by them greatly, right? They bless us. We see them and we rejoice. But as easy as I think it is for us to look at other people, I think we need to read the verse again. Those who fear you shall see me. Let those who fear you turn to me. Oh, that's personal application. I didn't want that. It's a lot easier to think about how other people refresh me. I don't want to think about how I refresh other people. But But the psalmist is saying this about himself. So I want you to use this verse as a measure for your own life. How are you being a blessing? How are you filling up? How are you a cup filler for other believers in your life, right? If God's blessed you to be a blessing, and so that's the big question. Am I a joy to other believers? Am I? And again, I know how my heart processes this. I am the worst critic. All I think about is just the opposite. I think about how unhelpful I am, how much of a joy robber I am for other believers, let alone trying to be an encouragement. That's just not my ministry. I don't know if I do that. If I did, it's an accident, right? You may be going, how do I ever influence anyone in a positive way? I'm always just grumpy. I'm the Christian Eeyore. But the Lord says, you are a joy because you're a joy to me because of, again, second big idea, who God says you are going to be a joy. Your presence is just an encouragement that you got yourself bright and early on a Saturday afternoon to get to church by 6. That's so encouraging, you guys. We didn't think many of y'all would make it. Like when you come to church and you're singing and you hear these brothers and sisters just singing about how good God is, oh, that fills me up. When I'm sitting in a sermon and I hear the pastor cut some people and get them a little rough around the, like convicting them to the bone with the Bible, and then I hear somebody go, amen. I'm like, yeah, that dude dared to say it. Amen, I love that. That fires me up. I come to church and my kids have rad teachers teaching them about Jesus. That fills me up. The things that your friends say, the things that you say, it's a compliment, it's a conversation, it's a, hey, how are you? It's a looking at them and saying, how you been? It's a when you're meeting up and just getting coffee or you're having people in your home or you're sharing a meal or you're showing up to small group and you have nothing to say and you feel like I'm just the dumbest one in here and I can barely read English, let alone have anything that that person says. It's so profound, but I'm here. That fills me up. Thanks, man. We haven't hung out very long. Another way maybe to ask the question for the negative Nancys in this room, you don't want to go like, I don't know how I can be a joy, but maybe is there things in your life that are preventing you from being more of a joy? Maybe it is just the, I'm just always mad and sad about myself. Maybe if I shift my focus off of me and to Jesus and to others, I could look through a different lens and things would be a little bit better. Maybe it's you're just really busy and that's hard for you to be present and be around and to be a joy. Your work schedule's tough, school, stress, maybe it's a house project or two or it's vacation plans. You got lots of stuff on your plate and you got to get it all knocked out. You're just really focused on getting tasks done. And those can be all really good things and at the same time rob you of joy and the cup filler that you could be in those moments. You ever been so busy trying to get things done? Like, we got to get to this place at this time. It's like you're going to pizza with your family, but we got to be there in 9 minutes, and it's going to be 13 minutes, and you just steal everybody's joy. That is me with everything. Pray for my kids. That's so sad. We can be doing all the awesome, good things, productive things, responsibility things, and robbing people of joy around us because we're so distracted on getting tasks done or laundry done or projects done that we can't even think about being a blessing. I'll be a blessing when all that stuff's done. Guess what? It'll never be done. Parents, this starts at home. Those who fear you, those who love you shall see me and rejoice. This starts in the ministry of the family, okay? Fathers, put your phones down. Look at your children in their eyeballs and love them and serve them and sing to them and play with them and wrestle them and dance with them. Help them with their homework. Help them with their reading. Help them with their math that you have to lie to them and Google to find out. Help them. My son's in fifth grade now. I can't do his math. I'm like, your mom will help you when she gets home, bud. But try. Ask them about their day. Tell them about yours. Fill their cups up while they're still in your home. And also say this, there's seasons, right? You need to be filled up. Let those who fear you turn to me. There are going to be times in your life where your prayer is, Lord, I need somebody. I need you. And I also need somebody right now. There's going to be seasons of your life like that, and that's fine. That's a sweet mercy from the Lord that he provides people for you in those situations that will come alongside you and carry your burdens and that will cry over you and they will pray over you. And we can thank God. We rejoice over those things, right? There's been seasons in my life where the Lord, through the life of other believers, have just shown up and ministered to me and filled me with joy when there was none. And I am so grateful that people would just show up and pray and sit and cry in the worst seasons. And I know you have people like that too. There will be seasons where you need people to fill you up. And likewise, there may be a day when you're in the position where the Lord calls you to the mercy. He calls you up to the plate into a season of somebody else like that, where you've experienced that kind of grace and compassion and sympathy. And then God now pulls you to the plate and says, now I need you to start swinging and helping this child. But you and I were these living temples, and we're God's representatives, and we're going to have endless opportunities to be a source of joy to everyone that we encounter. Because God's love has changed our relationship with him forever. That's a cool verse. You should go home and read it. There it goes. God's word has changed our relationship with him. His word has told us he's changed our relationship with ourselves, and God's word has the power to change our relationships with one another. That's a truly beautiful and unique and bold statement to make about this book. Am I right? But that's who God says we are, people who have been changed, and our lives are going to reflect that. So I challenge you, beloved, to daily come here and be changed by the word of God. Be renewed. I challenge you to daily come to the throne of grace, pray, reach out, yod, stretch out arm, reach out, extend to God. It will change you. And come to Jesus and believe what he says about you daily. That will change you. Show up daily into the lives of your brothers and sisters and the world and the people who don't know everyone. Just show up and pour yourselves out. Like Jesus says, they will know you by your love. That will change you. So let's go to prayer. Let's thank God for the wonderful work he's done in our lives. Amen? Okay. Lord, we thank you for your word. It is so vital for our lives. All right, there's really no life apart from you and your word, Lord. It's where we find you, the author of life. How can we expect to find life anywhere but from you? Lord, when we come to your word, we come to read, we come to hear from you, we come to hear your word preach. God, it's just because we want to experience you. This is where we can come, and so we live in dependency of that because you've changed us with your word. And so, Lord, I pray that you'd continue to transform us, that you'd continue to conform us, you'd renew our minds, you'd just totally change who we are as sons and daughters of you. And Lord, I pray that you'd help us to believe what you say about us, what you say about us. I pray against the lies in our heads and the flesh and the world, that we instead would just believe you. Lord, what a joy it would be if we would just really believe you. Because your spirit is in us, Lord. We are your sons and your daughters. We also have this incredible impact and influence to change the trajectory and the joy and to fill up the lives of the men and women and children in the world around us. So, Lord, I pray you'd help us with that. You've blessed us with every heavenly blessing. And so, God, we just want to give it away. You fill us up daily. So would you just make it impossible for us not to overflow with everyone we come in contact with? Would you help us to believe that? To be men and women who are just eager to give our faith away, Jesus. We say that in your name. Amen.
Amen. Thanks, Brian. Let's stand up and we'll sing one final song. Thank you. yours.
My life is yours. My hope is in you only. And my heart you hold. 'Cause you made this sinner holy and holy. Holy. Your glory is so my life is to worship in your light, 'cause your glory is so beautiful. Your glory is so beautiful. My life is yours.
God bless you, church. Thanks for singing with us. Have a great week. We'll see you next time.